Everybody, Hugo makes a quilt, your first one, right?
Yeah.
Now, many of you may need a sewing machine, and if you're a new quilter, you might just be getting grandma's out of the closet or mom's out of the closet. I've got two sewing machines right here that are both old, and I want you to know they would work just fine. These are actually old antique Singer sewing machines. These are called Singer Featherweights because, try to pick it up, Hugo, it's pretty light. Yeah, it's not too bad. I had to do a workout for me. And the red one is, it's probably beyond repair and making it black. Somebody could have made it black, but it's popular these days to get a featherweight done, remade, and this one is my red one. The point being, all we're going to do is doing straight stitches right now. So as you get started quilting, you may want to get into a nicer machine, and you can find those, but for what we're going to be doing, a regular sewing machine's fine, and I will be doing a tutorial on sewing machines, but I want to get to the project because I think that's what you want to do.
Okay, yep. And what is the project?
What is the project? Well, it's going to start with fabric, okay? So let's look at some fabric here. These fabrics I have pulled as if you were going to a quilt shop, and I want to talk about these for a moment. You will often find bundles of fabric. These are in fat quarters. That's fat quarters. Does that even ring a bell?
No.
See, fat quarters. So fat quarters, let's talk about this. First of all, you're Mr. Metric, you're European. So you're used to dealing with meters,
yeah.
Right? We deal with yards, right? And whenever you have a length of fabric and you go and you have it on the bolt in the store, you probably cut a yard or a yard mm-hmm. and a half or 2 yards. That's the length of the fabric.
Oh, the measuring. Oh my gosh. That's a kind of challenge because a yard and a meter, it's different. It's so different.
And so if you take a yard and you cut it in half, it's a half yard.
Mm-hmm.
If you take the half yard and cut it across in half, it's a quarter yard. And if I did 9 inches, 9 inches, 9 inches, and 9 inches, those are all quarter yards.
Okay.
But that would be a long, skinny quarter yard.
Mm-hmm.
So if I take a half yard and cut it in half the opposite way, then that becomes what we call fat quarter, okay? Fat quarters. And that's a big quilting term that you're going to learn, all right?
Fat quarters. Oh my gosh. Who invented this word? I think it was drunk.
So I've got some more here that are also fat quarters. Let me just pull one out and I'm going to show you what I'm talking about. It's not so big, but they're very usable for quilters because quilters like generally to have a lot of fabric. And so this fabric, I happen to know that this is what we call the selvage.
Selvage.
I know it's a word, I'm gonna say it a million times and you'll eventually learn it. But the selvage is the finished edge of the fabric. When it comes off of a bolt, there's a finished edge, and that is the edge that goes all the way over, and generally in America or in our part of the world, it's 44 inches, might be 42 inches. But that's the width of the fabric. So at one time, this fabric was 44 inches that direction.
Mm-hmm.
Then it was cut into a half yard, and that long half yard was cut down the middle, which makes this a fat quarter. For this project, fat quarters will work, but I'm going to suggest that we stick with regular width fabrics. And the regular width fabrics are going to give you the opportunity to do some things.
Selvage. Another strange word for me, because to memorize this word, it's like sausage. I think it's going to be okay, but salvage. Yeah, salvage.
let's go shopping. So I want you to look on the table here. I've got an assortment of fabrics that are, I won't call them solids. Solid okay. meaning one basic color. Solid fabrics. These are textured solids. And they're also hand-dyed. And because they're hand-dyed, they have this kind of texture that you see here. Does that make sense? Do you see the...
Yeah,
the veining. Effects. Yep, the effects. That's great. That's a good word for it. But if you look at this fabric is printed. Mm-hmm. It has a printed design, and most all printed designs have repeats on them. This stack of fabric I really, really like. This is a beautiful set of fabric. And I want you to look at the chocolate-covered cherries, pretzels. I mean, it's really fun fabric. And these would be fine in a project. The bottom line with your quilt project is this. If you're looking at a pattern, which we're not doing today, but if you're looking at a pattern, you might say, well, I can use the color similar to the pattern, but I can also shake it up a little bit and choose something a bit different. So those could be fun fabrics. Now, because I'm guiding Hugo on his journey, I picked out fabrics that were already great for quilting. These are 100% cotton fabrics. They're lightweight to medium weight. They're not like flannels. They're not some strange kind of fabric. They're the kind of fabrics that you would find in a quilt shop or in other places where quilting fabric is provided. There are fabrics that are called batik fabric. So while
batik.
That's a big word. This is printed design. It is commercially made, but batik is a process that uses wax to do a resist so that if you put a pattern of wax on the fabric after it's been partially dyed, the wax doesn't allow the next layer of dye to dye over. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
It's resisting. So you end up with a batik. Almost all batiks don't have generally what you saw say as a right or wrong side. Yes, there is, and it can be a slight difference, but truly you won't notice it very much because the front and the back are almost identical. Do you see that? That's a batik. I also want you to feel this.
Yeah, it's like... I don't want to say raw, because it's
it is
like
a, yeah. Here's the thing, and that we the term that we use in quilting and sewing is the hand of the fabric. How does it feel in your hand? The hand of this fabric is crisp. It's very crisp. It's also dense, meaning the fibers that are creating the fabric are closely woven together. So it is a very, very tight fabric.
Okay.
All right. And that's what's making you feel what you feel.
So the end of fabric. I learned you can feel the different kinds of texture you have in a fabric.
So a batik, it's beautiful. I mean, first of all, a lot of us are addicted to batiks because look at the beauty. I mean, they're really, really beautiful fabrics, right? Now, if you look at a printed fabric, let me grab a darker one. And we look at the backside.
That's a brown.
Yeah, it's basically brown with some green flecks. But look at the backside. So the printing process doesn't go all the way through.
It's and like this one, okay.
It's like printing on paper with your home printer. It prints on one side and doesn't really print on the other unless you flip it over. So you don't generally see, you don't generally see the same thing on the back. You end up getting a right side and a wrong side, or a front side and a back side.
Yeah.
Okay. Some people don't like to use right and wrong because it sounds judgmental for the back of the fabric.
Mm-hmm.
That's a joke.
Oh.
Okay, think about it. You guys, right and wrong sides. So we don't want the back of the fabric to feel bad, so we're not going to call it wrong. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
You're trying?
Yeah.
You're trying. All right, so Hugo. And I've got a basket of fabrics here that you could find something in here that you like. I also would suggest for this project that you use maybe a black. This is a plain black. This is as solid as it gets. It's got some flecks of fiber bits on it, but that is a solid, plain black. That is as black as it gets. And in this pile, Let's move this over. In this pile, we're going to use this for the black, if you wanted black. It is not as black as this black, but it'll work as a black. Mm. The colors are not going to be as important as having a variety of light colors, medium colors, and dark colors. So if we were to look at this pile of fabric, let's start sorting them out into lights, mediums, and darks. What would you call these two fabrics?
Lights.
Lights, okay, so let's put them here. Let's find some mediums. I'll let you play. I don't want to be the guy running the show the whole time.
Well, this is a light one.
Yep,
this light. Is a dark.
Yep.
I think this is a part of dark. I think all the rest is medium.
So you think this should be medium? Or do you think this should be dark?
Yeah, this pink is a primary color.
So here's how I go about it. There is no question, I think if I take this one out of the mix for right now, there is no question that these are light
yeah.
and that is dark. So we could start pulling this. This looks darker. When you squint with your eyes, you can see that this really looks darker than everything else mm-hmm. that's there, and it looks darker than this one
yeah.
for sure. So that's going to help you decide if this one should be in the dark pile or if it should stay in the medium pile. Squinting is a really good technique. So yes, I agree with you. This should be over in the dark pile. This one becomes questionable, but I feel because it's kind of brightly colored, it plays better with these.
Mm-hmm.
Would you agree? The only other one I'm questioning right now, this one is kind of dark, but it's also...
You still have colors.
Lots of colors in it. And this green one here, this one, it also feels a bit dark when I put it next to some of these other ones, but I still think it fits in here.
Yeah.
I could put it there.
No.
No, you're going to decide to be over here. All right. What we're going to do for now is we're going to take our light fabrics, we're going to take our dark fabrics, we're going to set them aside. I'm not going to use those for a while. And we're going to start playing with your fabrics to make your project. And that's going to happen on the next episode of Hugo Makes a Quilt.